Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Spiros Iosifidis, and I'm working for the management body of the Marine Park of Apollonissos for the last 12 years. Some notes about the history and the geography of the marine protected area. The National Marine Park of Apollonissos is a unique cluster of islands of high ecological, aesthetic, and cultural historical value. It's host to one of the most important population in the world of the monk seal, and also various rare endangered flora and fauna species coexist. And also significant underwater seagrass formations of extensive Posidonia beds up to 30 meters deep with major ecological and economical roles. And remarkable coralligenous and other calcareous bioconcentrations of rock gorgons and red gollard and like threatened species. It was the first MPA in Greece, a marine protected area, and the largest in the Mediterranean Sea, and I think in Europe. It was institutionalized by presidential decrees in 1992 and common ministerial decision in 2003. It is located in the North and West Aegean Sea and includes six islands and 22 islets. Apollonissos, Peristera, included in Zone B, the inhabited zone. Skagora, Kyria Panagia, Jura, Psathura, and Piperi insist the Zone A, the main protected zone, while Piperi and the 3 nautical mile buffer zone is the core of the park and a strictly protected no-take zone. Recently, in the year 2018, two more Natura sites were added under National Marine Park's responsibility. And as you see, there is a huge area to be monitored and protected that needs a lot of equipment, staff, infrastructure, and of course economic resources. Apart from marine area, there is also remarkable terrestrial flora in the land, insisted by a wide variety of trees and shrubs that are forming various types of habitats. The most typical are the pine forest, the machia vegetation, and the brushwood, in Greek, phrygana. The combination of land and sea creates the ideal conditions for seabirds like this lovely Larus anduin, Anduin's gull, the shark, the Yelkuan sea warder, Scopolis sea warder, and two predators, the Eleonora's falcon and the Bonellis eagle. In the marine environment, there are three predominant species of cetaceans, the striped dolphin, the bottlenose dolphin, and the common dolphin. But the main actor of the area is, of course, the monk seal, where a very important population finds shelter in the caves and in steep rocky shores, mainly in the coral zone. As some words for the monk seal, since 1996 it was ranked as critically endangered in IUCN Red List. However, since 2014, its conservation status improved and moved as endangered. That means, I think, that there is an improvement in status that may reflect the efforts to increase the population of the species in the Aegean region. And also is included as priority species in EU legislation and national legislation. And there is also remarkable marine flora, flora and fauna, about 300 fish species, extensive and very good condition Posidonia oceanica meadows, threatened species, as I said before, Corallian rubrum, Pinna nobilis, and various species of gorgonias. And famous for the island's economy is also the Alonsus tuna, the Thinus alalunga. And some imaging photos from the underwater natural wealth. As you see, there is an amazing environment. And of course, there is also cultural wealth, like the classic shipwreck of Peristera, a unique classic shipwreck that had been discovered. And it was an 80-ton cargo-built ship built in the 400 before Christ, with 3,000 or 4,000 amphorae in his hold. It was sunk in all one route from Chalkidiki to Skopelos, and it's we can note that the exact number and location of sunken vessels in a national marine park is not fully known yet. The diving tourism is one of the fastest growing recreational sports, and it involves a multi-billion dollar industry worldwide. In 1990, there was about 14 million divers worldwide, and it is estimated that up to 1 million new certifications issued annually. That means we have 1 million new divers every year. Diving tourism is the most friendly recreational activity for the marine environment because it does not extract organisms like the fishing does. It is considered to be as a low impact and highly education ecotouristic activity. Well, however, there is some impact that you must not overlook. Raising sediment is the most frequent effect produced by divers. According to several studies, 70% of divers has at least one contact with sensitive marine organisms during a 7-minute observation. And according to other studies, it's estimated that during a 1-hour dive, the divers could have up to 18 contacts with sensitive marine organisms. 50 contacts are caused by unintentional fin kicks caused by poor swimming techniques and the lack of buoyancy control that indicates that there is a poor diving proficiency. One contact is caused by another part of the body, a knee or elbow, and two contacts are caused by scuba gear. And also there is some impact on, I think, important one from the anchorage, and we have a destruction of some benthic organism, and also more damage. Studies have proved that more damages caused by the anchor chains, and there are many more damages from the anchors instead the. From the chains instead the anchor. Sorry, I'm complicated. And these are for example species that have, as you see, there is a proportional growth of damage according to the number of anchorages. The solution is one: the permanent anchor mooring systems, and I think the more divers prefer this solution because it's more easy for the diving centers to use these anchors instead of pull and drop and continuously the chain and the anchors. We can present the recreation diving system by this graph. This is the marine environment. This is the local community. These are the divers. And one can suppose that these are the net profits. But our question is not these profits, but these profits, this golden radio, including the diving centers, the essential role of diving centers, that's because they have to point out positive environmental aspects, describe norms of prescriptive norms of behavior, to increase and reinforce accountability about the MPA creation, about the regional or local importance of diving tourism and the user's responsibility, and also to increase the self-efficacy of the divers, caution during descent, yes, the buoyancy control, and recommendations for photographers. All this could be attained by pre-dive educational scuba briefings. That is about 10 minutes, I think, not more. Or that it could be a video or a leaflet or a presentation. Actually, in the marine park is just three diving areas and all included in Zone B. That means for the rest of the area there is no diving accessibility, no monitoring, and simultaneously no proper protection, because our experience all these years have shown that as isolated is one area is as unprotected. And all these years we conclude that neither the full protection of the marine biodiversity nor the preservation of the underwater cultural heritage has been achieved. The solutions. We propose to follow this equation of success: the added value of local natural and cultural resources plus local business creativity and ability to provide unique services and experiences plus targeted visitors at any cost, very important, minus the negative environmental externalities, yields the sustainable niche tourism. That yields sustainable economic growth, and this is the blue growth. We talk about the blue growth. And in conclusion, the endurance of culture and tourism in times of recession, a current state in Greece and many other Mediterranean countries, could have a multiplier effects for local economies as a whole. Second, diving recreation sports present a promising activity at global level considered as an appropriate conservation mechanism. Third, biodiversity conservation and diving tourism go hand in hand, relationships of accumulated intelligence alongside distributed interdisciplinary knowledge, citizen science, values and communication. And for the last, a shift to a brand name, diving destination, and a place of memory and cultural enrichment is urgently needed if the National Marine Park is meant to keep its credentials as an ecotouristic park. Do you have time for a 5-minute video, please?
Yes, of course.
It's an example for from Brazil, a country that is not in the European Union, but is the best practice for me. And this is the video briefing before the diving.
Águas azuis e transparentes, e cenário deslumbrante. Assim é Arraial do Cabo, uma joia na região dos lagos, no estado do Rio de Janeiro. Para os mergulhadores, o Caribe brasileiro. Arraial do Cabo tem ainda uma riqueza oculta. A geografia e correntes marinhas criaram um verdadeiro oásis para a vida marinha. Águas profundas e frias vêm para a superfície nos costões menos abrigados. Na enseada formada pela ilha de Cabo Frio, os costões são banhados por águas mais quentes. Espécies de peixes e invertebrados, tanto tropicais quanto de águas mais frias, podem viver em Arraial do Cabo. É um dos locais com maior biodiversidade marinha do Brasil. Em 1997, foi criada uma unidade de conservação federal, a Reserva Extrativista Marinha, ou RESEXMAR, de Arraial do Cabo, gerida pelo Instituto Chico Mendes da Conservação da Biodiversidade, o ICMBio. Na RESEXMAR, existem regras que visam proteger o modo de vida tradicional dos pescadores artesanais e conservar a vida marinha. Com tanta riqueza, a região é considerada a capital do mergulho no Brasil. Uma atividade que cresce a cada ano e traz recursos para a população local e mais um incentivo para preservar a vida marinha. Afinal, é sempre melhor mergulhar num local preservado e repleto de vida. Na RESEXMAR de Arraial do Cabo, vivem inúmeras espécies carismáticas, belas e importantes. Muitas delas são endêmicas e vivem somente na costa brasileira. Para garantir que os costões da RESEXMAR de Arraial do Cabo continuem cheios de vida para sua próxima visita e tornar o seu mergulho ainda mais agradável, temos algumas dicas. Anote aí! Não colete nada, nem animais mortos ou conchas. Leve somente fotografias. Não toque nos animais. Você pode quebrar corais que levam anos para crescer. E alguns animais podem machucar o mergulhador. Procure fazer a sua descida num fundo de areia. Assim fica mais fácil fazer o ajuste de flutuabilidade e evitar cair sobre os animais aderidos ao fundo rochoso. Mantenha sempre a flutuabilidade neutra e procure nadar horizontalmente, com as nadadeiras levemente acima do corpo e mantendo uma distância segura do fundo. Assim você não toca o recife, economiza ar ao se mover menos e não levanta a suspensão. Tudo isso ajuda você a observar melhor a vida marinha. Quando for fotografar, não toque o fundo. Garanta uma flutuabilidade neutra e se aproxime devagar, nadando ao redor dos animais. Assim você consegue se aproximar sem assustar os seres marinhos, garantindo imagens melhores. E ainda garante a saúde do recife e a sua, ao não cair sobre animais que podem te ferir. A responsabilidade de manter o belo cenário da RESEXMAR Arraial do Cabo como um oásis para a vida marinha é de todos, visitantes e moradores. Aproveite o mergulho e divulgue essa ideia.
That's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We continue with the last speech. Mr. Papadimitriou is a faculty member of the School of Rural Surveying Engineering of Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, and he's going to talk about the modern wrecks in Greece, the need to survey and highlight this unknown wealth.